Every good narrative needs a strong villain. I mean, I likely wouldn't be so determined to eat 80 pieces of popcorn chicken if Jules and Ash weren't such turbo vegans, but I'll leave it up to you as to who the heroes and villains are in that scenario. Anyway, in gaming, when you can say, "That's who I'm going to be fighting in 80 levels and 100 hours time," it makes for a pretty damn awesome sense of drive. But what about the villains that look totally unassuming for the vast majority of playtime? The noisy crickets of the gaming world who, when the trigger is pulled, launch you across the room. If at first they don't look like they could succeed, that might just be because their master plan hasn't come together yet. Or they're yet to inject themselves and Hulk out. We are talking about video games here. I'm Scott from WhatCulture.com, and these are the 10 most unexpectedly powerful video game villains. Number 10, The End. Metal Gear Solid 3, Snake Eater. Of all the bosses in Metal Gear history, there is none less intimidating than The End. An incredibly frail individual who's so stationary that he's literally begun to photosynthesize, The End leaves most scenes before he's had a chance to do anything. After battling two other members of the Cobra unit, one who's basically a predator and another that controls literal bees, it's a bit disappointing to be fighting an old man who struggles to open his eyes. Then, when it comes time to fight though, he totally transforms. Tranking Snake over and over, running around between three separate combat arenas, and that photosynthesis trait? Yeah, it means he's gonna be recovering energy to keep going until you put him down for good. The entire End fight is one of the most fun and challenging in gaming history, the player being drawn into a game of cat and mouse, where angles are everything, and if you're not getting the drop on your opponent, he is to you. Number 9, Ramon Salazar, Resident Evil 4. Resident Evil 4 is filled with horrifying creatures and terrifying undead monstrosities, including, but not limited to, giant worm-infested ogres, a man who would look more at home in Dead Space, and a sea monster also thrown in for good measure. So when you finally get to the moody gothic castle, most players were expecting things to escalate further. What awful eyeball-on-its-arm-style terror awaited us next? Well, it's an old man in a 10-year-old's body. It's the reverse of Rich Hudson, which, to be fair, is still equally terrifying. When Ramon Salazar first waltzes on screen with his tiny Napoleon outfit and awful accent, he doesn't exactly scream, "I'm going to be a super strong boss" later on. Consequently though, when Salazar does show back up later, he does exactly what you were waiting for, transforming into a mass of tentacles and blood, putting you down in a handful of hits if you get too close. Number 8, Emil, Nier Automata. Imagine a tuk-tuk, only instead of a windscreen, it has a horrifying moon face. Then imagine that same tuk-tuk is level 99, spews out endless attacks, and uses deadly weapons. That's what Emil is. Poor little Emil is a rare example of a villain who never wanted to be a villain though. In fact, he spends most of the game as a harmless shop vendor who's actually super charming. With his awesome, yes seriously, it's so absolutely delicious music, and cheerful voice, he just screams innocent and non-threatening. Then he turns into the tuk-tuk abomination I described, and one hell of a tough boss fight later, he's gone. However, if you take the time to complete some additional steps, Emil will return, but you'll totally regret it. This time, he's ridiculously large, near insane, and constantly spouts cryptic messages that only make sense if you played the original Nier. Not only that, but after beating this grueling fight, Emil will just self-destruct, triggering one of the game's 26 different endings and taking the whole damn planet with him. Nice job, everybody. I guess we just had to antagonize the secret boss. Number 7, Atlas / Frank Fontaine, Bioshock. Perhaps one of the greatest betrayals in all of video games comes from the just plain nice to know he's your friend Atlas, revealing he's the big bad instead. Previously, Atlas was with the player throughout the entire game, constantly guiding you and presenting himself as an everyday person. When it turns out that he was actually Frank Fontaine the entire time, leader of a rebellious group in Rapture before it went to hell, obviously you were more than a little upset. But you know, not to worry, betrayals happen, people lie, it's all par for the course. I mean, we were gonna go to E3 at one point, and that's not gonna happen. Sure, Atlas betrayed you, but he doesn't sound especially threatening. I'm sure he'll be easy to have a word with. Oh, he's pumped himself full of Adam and turned into a giant orange rage monster. How quaint. Did he not see how much no one liked Titan Joker in Arkham Asylum? What happens next is a blur of combat annoyance, deflation of expectation, and the once lovable Atlas hitting you with more force than anything else you've fought until that point. Number 6, A Bunch of Rats, any Warhammer fantasy game. The Warhammer universe is a dark one. Filled with creatures of absolute abstract terror and destruction, not only has it been on the edge of destruction for many years, but it actually ended. As in, it's all gone and the bad guys totally won. So what the hell was powerful enough to do that? Demons, chaos, Josh's hairspray? No, turns out the answer is rats. Just a metric F-ton of big mean rats. Except they all come equipped with mini nukes strapped to their backs. Admittedly, there is a bit more to the Skaven than just being big rats, but still, that's the general gist. So whenever they show up in any Warhammer-related works, it's always a bit of a shock to newer players that these are the things that raised the entire old world to the ground like it was nothing. Number 5. Orphan of Kos, Bloodborne. The Orphan of Kos is an interesting example of unexpected power. On the one hand, he's a Bloodborne boss, so any smart player will walk up to him with more than a bit of reservation. On the other hand though, he looks like a weak, malnourished idiot wielding a giant shrimp. It's not exactly intimidating. Appearing at the end of DLC The Old Hunters, the Orphan is one of the last obstacles for you in a slew of difficult fights. Single-handedly the hardest boss in Bloodborne, maybe even the Souls franchise as a whole, Kos' attacks are brutal, his speed doubly so, and obviously he has a second phase because who in these games does not? Yet, when compared to other boss battles such as Lawrence the First Vicar, it's ridiculous to think that this shrimp-wielding menace is more difficult. After countless hours of trying and failing to kill the Orphan, almost everybody in the Soulsborne Ero community agrees that he's no joke. Number 4. Arden, Final Fantasy XV. When it comes to white-haired, katana-wielding, egotistical anime swordsmen, you might think Final Fantasy reached its peak with Sephiroth. The man, just like most other Final Fantasy villains of the past, is introduced as unflinching, unstoppable, and most importantly, near godlike in power. The One-Winged Angel became the benchmark for Final Fantasy villains, and halfway through Final Fantasy XV, you were likely asking yourself, when is the main villain ever going to show up? Well, buckle up, because Arden reveals himself not only as the game's final foe, but also, basically, the devil himself. First seen earlier in the game where he turns up for a conversation and not much more, later on he's boasting all the same powers as Noctis. This madman actually achieves his goals towards the end of the game too, despite the fact that he looks like a drunken fighter from a Namco game. Then to really put the icing on the overpowered cake, Arden fights you Dragon Ball Z style, the game's mechanics changing to incorporate flight and a city hopping scale. It's absolutely nuts, to be honest. Number 3. Toru Adachi, Persona 4. Behind Persona 4's veil of upbeat J-pop and wacky school shenanigans lies a dark and twisted plot involving shadow monsters, alternate worlds, and a serial killer driving everything forward. The player follows along as the party slowly unravels this murder mystery. Honestly, it's one of the best ever. And the question at the core is who the hell is killing all these women? Worse, who could be powerful enough to do so in an alternate demon world? Though the game does a good job of making it feel like anything goes, when the bumbling, fresh-faced detective Toru Adachi is behind everything, it's genuinely the last major shock left. If this were a normal murder mystery, all would be fine. Adachi would be arrested, taken to court, and tried like every other killer. Instead, this is a video game and this is Persona. Adachi hops back into the demon world and reveals that he too has a power-enhancing persona. Somehow, after 80 hours of grinding at this point, it's also way stronger than all of your party combined. Cue a mega hard final boss battle and a wet fart of a human being wiping the floor with everyone you care about. Number 2. Senator Armstrong, Metal Gear Rising: Revengeance. The most unbelievable thing about Metal Gear Rising: Revengeance is that a University of Texas alumni turned senator is the single most powerful person in the Metal Gear universe. Because yes, Kojima tweeting that this thing doesn't belong in the Solid universe still makes it canon. In a world filled with superhuman cyborgs and giant titular Metal Gears, the player is obviously going to approach the end of the game expecting an epic, tense, action-packed finale with something bigger and badder than anything before. So when Senator Armstrong waltzes out and spouts some of the most memeable lines in any game ever, I mean literally dude says nanomachine son, flashing his veiny rock-hard pecs to pummel Raiden into submission, it's honestly one of the most shocking out-of-nowhere fights in Metal Gear. Cue multiple transformations, lightning-fast attack flurries, tiny counter windows, and taunts left, right, and center. Senator Armstrong flattens Raiden into a fine paste, and he loves doing it. It takes a lifetime to whittle down his 200% life bar with your literal 0.1% attacks as well. And Armstrong is an absolute tank, becoming one of the internet's favorite final bosses of all time. And number 1, Flowey, Undertale. Upon first meeting Flowey, the player would be forgiven for assuming that he was just a nice little flower with a nice little face, helping you along on your nice little adventure. But that would be a lie. Flowey wants nothing more than the total destruction of you, your face, and every face you hold dear, even your cat's face. After a few moments of niceties and colourful introductions, Flowey introduces some friendship pellets, only to then deal damage because secretly he's a murderous psychopath. Much later in the game, Flowey then comes back to comment on your actions, only to morph into an eldritch horror meets my first Photoshop abomination. When Omega Flowey appears, he is absolutely huge. So huge that he's not even in the same pixel art style as the rest of the game. Dude is ugly, a mush of teeth, eyeballs, tentacles, and maniacal laughter. Flowey's final form has done the rounds on the internet today, but back in 2015, coming across him at 2 a.m. when trying to finish this, it was absolutely freaking horrifying. And that is my list, the biggest, baddest flower petalist of them all. Let me know which other unassuming characters had your shins for breakfast down in the comments. For now, I've been Scott from WhatCulture.com. Please check out the WhatCulture Gaming podcast. Use the WCGP tag to keep in touch on Twitter, and I'll catch you soon.